Monday, and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad Vries, and this is our weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
Hey there, Collider TV Talk fans. We are psyched to be here. All of us are wearing somewhat of a black shirt, except for, oh, David Griffin did bring a black shirt. Look at that. And it's Batman.
I can wear black. I can pull off black.
Listen.
In more ways than one, if you know what I'm saying.
Zing, love it. You got two bearded dudes and two hot girls talking TV. Sinead, who else is here?
Also here is Sasha Perl-Raver.
Sinead and I did wear our matching black tank tops. It's very exciting. And this episode of TV Talk is going to be brought to you by Boob Sweat. It's hot. Let's get it going.
And also here is David Griffin.
Oh, hey. Oh, another introduction. Hey, what's happening? David Griffin here. Nice seeing you. I got a Star Trek poster behind me, people. Star Trek.
Before we get into it, before we start getting Twitter whatever, they still have yet to announce a Stranger Things Season 2 from Netflix. Mm-hmm. There have been all kinds of conflicting stories from different outlets, whether it's the Inquisitor or some websites people have sent me on Twitter. They are, all the showrunners and the producers are talking about what they would do with a season two, but Netflix has yet to announce anything. They're keeping it very secret. So again, there still is no announcement on Stranger Things. So Sinead, what is first?
At the CBS All-Access panel at the TCA Press Tour, Bryan Fuller, showrunner and executive producer of the much-anticipated Star Trek Discovery, confirmed a few details. The series will be 13 episodes to start and will feature a female lead who will not be a captain, but a lieutenant commander. Casting hasn't started yet, but they will be shooting soon. This Star Trek will take place in the Prime universe, not the Kelvin universe of the movies, and the timeline will take place 10 years before Captain Kirk's five-year mission, and will act as a bridge between Scott Bakula's Enterprise series and the original. Again, let's go to David. How does this news affect your opinion of what this iteration of Star Trek will look like?
I mean, I've been excited for this from the get-go. I mean, this just affirms, I don't know, more of my excitement. I'm just very excited for this. I mean, the diversity. Okay, I mean, you know, we're gonna have different races. We're gonna, besides just alien races, we're gonna have, you know, people different sexual orientations, which is all good. Now, I mean, I think my opinion, I think Sinead should be the lieutenant commander, and I could be her number one.
Ooh.
You know, that's what I would pitch to CBS. See, right there, CBS, you got your casting done.
I'll be in the background drinking a beer. Like,
yeah,
you guys need me to do things on the ship or just hang out? It's like a cruise through space, guys. I'll be on the Lido deck if you need me.
I mean, the only thing that kind of worries me a little bit is just the fact that it's going to be on CBS All Access. They're going to do the premiere on the main CBS channel. Yeah. Going to go straight to digital, which you have to pay an extra fee for, even if you have a CBS, you know, subscription with your DirecTV or your cable, whatever. So that worries me a little bit to see how many people are going to pay the extra money to see this series. I hope it warrants it. I want this premiere to be good enough where people are like, oh, I'm definitely going to pay an extra $6 a month to watch this. That's the thing we're going to have to wait and see.
I think the one thing I got from reading a bunch of the articles about this, you know, the female lead, all this kind of stuff is, and I hope this doesn't come out the wrong way. Usually the things I do come out the wrong way, but I stumbled over all the words there.
Yeah. Did you have a point to this?
We're gonna cut, and we're back here on Collider TV Talk, guys. Josh Macuga here. I just hope they don't shove the diversity in our face, like, this guy's gay, black, Asian, Native American, and trans. And you're like, Jesus, like, how much diversity can we get? Like, I understand that they want to be diverse and all the characters want to be this, this, and this, but I don't want them to, like, oh, we're just for the shock value of it all. She's going to have one leg, and that leg is the only gay thing in her body. Like, that, I don't know, like, because every time they talk to me, like, this is going to be the most diverse show ever. Gay aliens, straight aliens, all of them. It's just like, I know this is sounding very, whatever, Macuga-ish, but it just doesn't seem like it really has a place of, like, we're gonna shove this down your throat because that's what it is.
I know what you're saying. I think, though, that if you go to the original series, mm-hmm. they're gonna go that way.
Okay.
Like, the original series had Asian actors, had black actors, had white people. I mean, now apparently we know at least one of the characters was gay, at least if we're going off of, like,
the Kelvin universe.
Yeah, the Kelvin universe. Mm-hmm. So I think it's more that. They're just trying to, like, pay homage to what the original series did, but, like you said, David, I'm very concerned about, I don't know, $6 a month?
Yeah.
$6 a month for just, what else do I get with that?
I think you get access to all of CBS's shows, I'm assuming. Probably like an HBO.
But do I get those anyway?
See, that's the thing. If you already have DirecTV or something, you're already paying your cable bill, why would you pay on top of your cable to get the same content? That's what worries me.
This is where I'm going to borrow somebody's password. Anybody got a password? Send it to me. I'll buy you some fries.
Go to my email address, bighotstuds69@hotmail.com. No, I think that... the one thing that, okay, so like ABC Digital, NBC Digital, sure. they have a lot of cool little web series that they put on there. Same as Comedy Central.
But they're included.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly. I think, and basically ABC Digital is free if you have cable or whatever, or if you it's partnered with certain things. But I think what CBS is doing is they're hoping that this Star Trek will get those people to sign on for this thing, even if it's more. We've talked about this before. If you're not, if CBS isn't offering something other than the Star Trek, you're really going
to
start.
And maybe they're playing to the people who have are cord cutters. There are a lot of cord cutters out there. So sure. like, well, look, you don't have cable anyway. $6 a month's not bad. You get access to all of our shows. Some people are going to be like, oh, I'll do that.
But how many people do you think will wait until the series has right. aired in its entirety and then drop $6 binge for it. 1 month, yeah. binge yeah. the whole thing? Because I mean, that's such smart. An easy thing. And then yeah. you only have to use it for 2 or 3 days.
If you have cable, do you get, like I have cable. So when I watch things online, I'm signing in with like AT&T UVerse.
Correct.
You know how it says like yes. select your provider.
I believe this is separate.
So it's still separate from, as far as we know. Even people with yeah. cable who have CBS
pay extra.
As part of their cable package, yeah. which is like everybody, yes. CBS.
It's like Hulu and whatever.
Yeah. They are still paying the separate correct. $6. Yeah. That seems ridiculous. Yeah. I can understand if you don't have cable, but if you do have cable, yeah. then like...
It's a bad business model. Right. It concerns me. I don't know that this is going to be as successful as they hope yeah. it will.
Mm. What was Seinfeld's line? It was an old episode. It was like, 75 cents for a pack of juicy fruit? That's ridiculous. That's like the same. Never mind. All right. You know the same? Cool. Sinead, what's next?
Deadline broke news that both Robert De Niro and Julianne Moore will star in a crime story set in the 1990s, directed and produced by Oscar-nominated director David O. Russell, best known for his work on Silver Linings Playbook and American Hustle. This is a major move for the director, who has never ventured into TV and would appear to be a must-buy for any outlet. The unnamed show looks to be set up for multiple seasons, but still may be a limited series. Sasha, where would you like to see this project?
Oh my God, on my TV right now. That sounds awesome. Now here's the thing. Robert De Niro has only made good projects with David O. Russell in the last like 6 or 7 years.
Did you like Joy?
I did not like Joy, actually.
Yeah, I thought it was, okay.
I thought it was overthought and underdeveloped narratively. But I love Silver Linings Playbook.
Yeah.
But I hated Dirty Grandpa.
Yeah.
Like bad.
And, I wasn't a big fan of, I thought American Hustle was overhyped.
I liked American Hustle. He did a horrible movie though with Al Pacino called like Righteous Kill that yeah. was total garbage.
That was De Niro and Pacino.
Yeah, awful. There's yeah. been a couple where it's just been
The Intern?
Oh,
anybody?
Well, that's what the one I was just gonna say is The Intern was on TV and Amanda was watching The Intern and I just turned it to the Olympics and she's like, I love this movie. Turned it to the Olympics, turned it back and she didn't even recognize because she was like on her phone. That's how bad The Intern was.
Oh my God.
It's not a good movie.
Does it worry you that, I mean, first of all, De Niro is one of my favorite actors of all time. The Godfather 1 and 2 are like considered my top two films of all time. Mm-hmm. But De Niro is gone are the days of Raging Bull yeah. and even Casino and Goodfellas. I mean, he kind of takes the safe roles. And look, I don't blame him. He has nothing to prove.
No.
Dude has, you know, Oscar's got millions of dollars. He's fine. But it just worries me. Like, I hope this is something that pushes him a little bit because I know he's one of the best actors of all time. And I want to see that. I feel like yeah. I haven't seen that in a long time.
And Julianne Moore is incredible.
Oh, yeah.
My biggest concern with this, I mean, I think chances are this will either go HBO or Netflix because mm-hmm. it's such a prestige project.
Yep.
But my biggest concern is David O. Russell is
a madman.
So I have a friend who's worked on a number of films with him and basically has said that there is rarely a script when you show up on set. Everything kind of gets thrown out the window. Every day is just a melee. And within a film constraint, you can kind of make that work.
Mm-hmm.
When you're doing television outside of, I would say, the Netflix model where they really trust their filmmakers, I think there's too many network notes. There's too much input. There are too many cooks in the kitchen for David O. Russell to be able to yep. rein himself in and deliver. Wait, but what's your friend's experience?
Oh, no, I mean, my friend's experience when he worked on American Hustle, it was absolute madness. David O. Russell would, like, he would say, cut, and he'd be looking like, I can see your toenails, and I don't like them. And he'd be like, get off my set. And, like, he would make a PA leave and then come back or whatever. They would make him put on shoes or something weird. Like, he is a madman.
Mm.
TV, and we're going to talk about it when we get to the Get Down. Baz Luhrmann is a really well-known guy and difficult to work with, and it is apparent in The Get Down. We'll talk about that more when we get to The Get Down, but I'm with you on this one.
I know there's a little sidetrack. It's always funny because you look at a guy like David O. Russell, looks like, you know, clean-cut, regular guy. You think Tarantino would be difficult to work with, but when you watch Tarantino's, like, behind the scenes, like, he always has this famous line where he's like, what do we like to do? It's like, because we love making movies, and yes. I heard everybody loves working with him, and it's funny. You think, like, a guy like Tarantino would be harder to work with, but it's crazy when you hear stories like that.
I think it's, you know, David O. Russell gets people to work with him, actors, actresses, that are just as crazy and kind of psychopathic as him, the same as, like...
Lawrence seems to work well under those conditions.
Yeah.
because she keeps going back with him. So she must enjoy it. She must like it.
But yeah. Julianne Moore does not fit that bill. Yeah, true, and yeah. like I think about what happened with Amy Adams on American Hustle, where she had like a very abusive situation mm-hmm. with him. I don't know that Julianne Moore. I mean, my assumption would be this would be 6 or 8 episodes. It will probably be on a streaming service, mm-hmm. is my guess. And I mean, maybe it'll be like a huge breakout project for like an Amazon.
Yeah.
And they'll kind of be hands off and let the director just do what he wants to do. I think it sounds cool. I hope that this happens. Also, I think that David O. Russell, when he goes more like Three Kings, is more interesting than when he goes Joy.
Yeah.
So I'd like to see more of like his cool, subversive originality.
And 1990s really isn't something we've ventured back into in nostalgic purposes.
Right.
It's like a forgotten decade, really.
It's
it has
been 20 years.
Yeah. It's just the fact that I think that people have left it alone because they don't consider it history yet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, People versus OJ.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's one story of the 90s.
And there's another one. There's a like a cocaine thing set, I believe, in Oakland. Oakland!
Oaktown.
357 Get Loose. Which is going to be on FX, that is being directed by John Singleton.
You're really great with all this FX plugging stuff.
I'm not even trying! Yeah.
Because you know why?
I wasn't even trying!
Because FX has the movies.
You guys! They don't even pay me to do this. I'm serious though, but that's set in the 90s. You know, I was bummed because I've always wanted to do something set around the Loma Prieta earthquake, which was 1989 in Oakland because I was there. Yeah. And then I was like, oh, bummed. Somebody took my idea. Talk amongst yourself. I'm Googling this.
Well, okay. Lucky for you, I was watching FX the other day and I heard you announce the movie this week. So I got
Zane,
your
we got it. Shenasty coming in hot. Okay, we're going to get to the point of the program where we have a lot of superhero news this week, guys. A lot of stuff going on in the Flash Arrow universe. So, Sinead, what is first?
In a discussion with MTV News while filming DC's The Justice League movie in London, actor Ezra Miller, who will play The Flash, teased us TV fans of the CW's The Flash with the possible meetup of the two Barry Allens. Miller said of Gustin, "He's a boss. I can't wait to see him eye to eye adrift in the Speed Force. Our eyes will lock, and in that moment, we will both know the truth. What truth? I dare not say." Josh, is your thought of bringing the DC TV and DC movie universe coming true?
Well, I think a while back on TV Talk, I said, why don't we just have Grant Gustin be The Flash in Justice League and whatever? And you were like, it was definitely like a good banter back and forth, classic TV Talk kind of moment. And
classic TV
Talk. But this
talk.
Is like, you know, this is kind of a funny way of saying it. Like, we'll lock eyes and in that moment we'll know we should have like given each other HJs in the Speed Force. Like, it's real like.
HJs?
Should I not have said?
HJs?
Sorry, Mrs. Griffin.
Oh, no.
Sorry, Mrs. Griffin. Did but, you just say HJs?
Yeah, what are you, 15?
I've never heard that.
I've heard
BJs,
Mrs. Griffin
but not
raised. Yeah. Yeah. You're a little more sophisticated.
I've never heard HJs before.
You know what, guys? I'm not.
You guys, it was John Singleton, and it said actually in the 80s, it's Los Angeles. Josh, don't leave. I'll give you an HJ.
Is that what bro say?
Absolutely.
Bro say HJ.
I'm going to get the bro jar. Like, if you know what that douche jar.
You got to put a dollar in the bro jar.
The bro jar needs to be a thing, and you need to put a dollar in it.
You're right. I went full bro jar.
No, it's okay. We should all give you an HJ to say we're sorry. Welcome back.
David, you're first.
I don't need that kind of attention right now.
There you go. Sorry, Mrs. Griffin. Really, really sorry. I've been watching too much Night Of, I think.
Oh, God. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow.
So, okay. No, I think this is pretty awesome. It's cool that they would like even think about their own Grant Gustin in the Justice League. I think this is what it's a cool thing. And what I thought of immediately when I saw it was like DC is trying to have a little bit of fun with their freaking movies. Finally. Right? With these things.
Supposedly. So.
Yeah. I hope this is fun. I'm excited for this. Yeah. I mean, have fun. I mean, these guys are both good. I like Ezra Miller. Every time I think of him, I think of a train wreck.
Yeah.
That scene was so good. I mean, he was so over
Spot
the top.
On.
And I can't wait to see what's going to do in the Justice League. I'd love these guys to meet up. Yeah. Yeah. Hopefully no HJs, but yeah, I'd love to see them meet up.
I always think of We Have to Talk About Kevin, and he freaks me out.
Yeah, he's got that creepy look to him, but like he's just, like Grant's more clean cut, and he's a little more, but look at that suit. I mean, it just fits. Yeah. I think it's going to work. It's going to work, yeah.
For sure. Yeah. All right, Sinead, what's next?
Dolph Lundgren, whose best-known Russian performance is most definitely Ivan Drago from Rocky IV, will star as a big bad in the Russian flashbacks during season 5 of the CW's Arrow series. It was also reported by producers of the show that this will be the last season of flashbacks in Arrow. David is adding Dolph Lundgren, the greatest casting news in TV history.
There's a lot of great news in here. It's nice to see that they're going to get rid of the flashbacks. I think for too long, the arrow has been stuck in these flashbacks.
They've been beholden to them,
if I can use that word, because I think they just relied on them. It was comfortable, and they kept doing it. So I'm glad that they're getting rid of
those. We're not going to apologize to Mrs. Griffin for that one. We're going to congratulate her as being a great mom for teaching you the word beholden.
Beholden, yes. I can throw a few words in the vocabulary there. Also, too, though, I want to talk about Dolph Lundgren, who is one of my favorite actors.
Yep.
Great action star. He has a degree from MIT. He's a smart man. Very smart man. I know he's
Yeah, exactly.
No, no. It's not MIT. It's MOU, Masters of the Universe. See what I mean? He was
Be that cricket noise. And also too, like, he's always fun to have on. I mean, Ivan Drago is one of the most iconic villain performances.
I must break.
You will lose if he dies. He dies.
You just made him very gay.
I messed that up. But no, I'm excited for this. So there's a lot of good news in this.
Dude,
no
I'm
more
like,
flashbacks.
Give me a star. And these Russian flashbacks we've been waiting for an arrow forever, and finally we're getting how he became a member of the Bratva. That gets me super excited. All right, Sinead, what's next?
The last time we saw Grodd, the sewer-dwelling metahuman gorilla, Barry Allen and his crew of geniuses sent him to Gorilla City on Earth 2. Fans of Grodd were treated to some news from producers at the TCAs that, quote, we're going to be doing a two-part episode that takes place in Gorilla City. The panel revealed that there will be two big bads this season, Dr. Alchemy and Savitar, who is also a speedster.
Yep.
David, Grodd! That's all. Just kidding. Give us a little breakdown of the two big bads.
Well, first, I mean, let's start with Grodd. We got a little taste of Gorilla City. I think we all thought on the Flash After Show that Zoom was going to bring Gorilla Grodd and his army to bear down on Barry and his friends. So they were going to use him. They did. We didn't really see Gorilla City. So I'm glad we're going to go back there. The CW always surprised you, especially with their special effects. Sasha, they did the King Shark character, which is exactly what you think it is, a giant man who's got a shark head for a head and a shark body. And he's
like
gigantic.
It's like my guy, shark-dressed man.
And the special effects actually look good. I mean, the gorilla looks good.
The gorilla actually looks good.
You know,
yeah.
Also, they use a gorilla in the show The 100, too. It did in the first season, looked really good as well. So, yeah, I think this is a good thing. I'm not as familiar with Dr. Alchemy.
Okay.
But, you know, the more villains, the better, in my opinion. I think DC has some of the best rogues gallery of any of the comic book
rogues gallery.
Mrs.
I'm
Griffin
throwing the words
teaching
out
you
It's a vocabulary day here. TV Tuck.
Got to use that English degree every now and then.
Yeah, we've got a plethora of stories to go through.
It's a cornucopia.
Oh, it's going to be a cornucopia.
Yeah.
Nicely done. I love Grodd. I'm so excited to see Gorilla City, too. He was one of my more favorite parts of last season of The Flash.
One of my favorite.
If you guys don't know who, I blew that. one of them favorite things I did there on the show was when they brought in the big guy with the hairy arms.
On them gorillas in the city. They got a whole city filled with them gorillas. I don't watch this show, but I would watch it for Gorilla City. I like them a lot.
Now, Sinead, what story is next here on Superhero Rundown?
All right. Well, do you guys like musicals and superheroes?
Yay!
That's great. You know why? Because it appears that the Flash and Supergirl crossover episodes could be musicals, which makes sense as most of the cast are Broadway actors with voices already featured on shows like Glee. A rumor about these episodes started by the hashtag show with sources close to production and not refuted by the director was that Avengers director Joss Whedon could be directing it. Again, this is all speculation, but Sasha, would Joss Whedon stepping onto the crossover make it worth watching?
Yes! By the way, so what you guys couldn't see during that story was David went,
aww. I like
and
musicals.
And then Joss Whedon was brought up and he went, okay.
That's okay.
Hello, Dr. Horrible, sing along.
Yep.
It would be rad. First of all, any musical makes me happy. Second of all, a musical superhero thing, I'm like beyond sold. And third, with Joss Whedon, yes. Is it in Gorilla City?
Oh, Gorilla City, Supergirl, Flash. Damn, gorilla. It's Gorilla City. Gorilla City. That's all musical theater. Listen.
And hey.
I lived in New York, I worked with a guy who was like one of those big Broadway guys and he'd always get me free tickets. And I don't like musical theater.
To be honest. Ew.
It was never for me. It never really equated. It was like, why sing when you can just act and move the story along without being like, ooh, we're in a city. Now let's sing a song about it.
Why just talk?
Sing a song.
You can sing a song.
Dance.
But hold on.
I saw Wicked. The first time I ever saw Wicked, I was in New York. I was spellbound by that show. Yeah, guys, we're going vocabulary.
Oh my God, I love it.
Absolutely. I went to see Wicked the day later. I even spent money on the ticket to see it. I loved Wicked. So then my buddies were like, you should check out this musical. You're like, this one. So there are some musicals that I like, but there are musicals that I don't like. I don't want to see a superhero musical crossover. I really don't. I don't think it really equates to me. What is he going to be like? I run fast and you fly fast. Together we're the fast flying running combo.
I think what's going to happen is it's going to be some sort of dream sequence where someone gets like hit in the head and it creates a musical. Or like there's going to be a villain who, this would be the coolest. His power is he makes people sing. Sinead, you were anti and now you're pro. No, I want your opinion on this.
I'm the bad guy. The bad guy. I'm gonna come in and take all your powers.
That didn't rhyme.
I know, but now it's musical theater.
Yes, it does.
Sometimes, but fussy. Like that. Like.
Fussy.
David,
I'm not anti this, but I just don't understand how they would make it work.
See?
It just, how could they just all of a sudden introduce
music? I'm Barry Allen. I do fast things, and I'm really good at science. David, take it.
Yes, this is too much for me. This is too much.
If it's like that,
why don't you like it, David? Tell us all about it.
I know me some musicals. My sister's an opera singer, first of all.
And then I
love Phantom of the Opera. It's my favorite musical. I can't wait till Hamilton comes to L.A. So we can watch it out here. So I like musicals, but I want to see just a badass Supergirl Flash crossover. I don't want to see them singing. I don't even, if I want to watch singing, I watch Beauty and the Beast or Little Mermaid because I got a thingamabob. I got plenty, you know, all that kind of stuff. See, I know songs, I can sing, but I just don't want to. I don't want to see this.
I'm really on your side of this. I think you know
it could be good. Who knows? I can see it. I can just be.
There are really great episodes of TV that are like Scrubs had a musical episode.
Yeah. Simpsons have done it well.
Obviously, Family Guy does it almost every episode. South Park. You're right. There are a lot of shows that do musical episodes where it makes sense because you can step away. And it's not part of the thing. This has no place in the world of superheroes.
The one way they could do it, Sasha, don't here's the thing. There are parallel universes that exist. So if they cross through a parallel universe that sings, you know, when things happen, then...
Earth 5, where we all sing.
We
sing.
I'm into it, dude. If you have Joss Whedon directing something, don't waste him on a musical. That's all I'm saying.
Why
I'm sorry.
David is that Griffin. A waste?
I'm sorry.
All right, Sinead, last story in Superhero Rundown.
All right, the CW Seed, which is a DC animated show best known for introducing Vixen, who then came to Arrow in live action form, will introduce the first gay superhero on the network known as The Ray. According to the CW, Ray Terrell first appeared in Justice League of America, number 107, in 1973, and whose powers focus on light manipulation and energy blasts. The series comes from Arrowverse creators Greg Berlanti and Mark Guggenheim, and it seems like The Ray is being developed to follow Vixen in making the jump to live action. David, thoughts on The Ray?
Well, it's great. I mean, it's just, like you said, with diversity, it's tricky because you want shows to be diverse. I mean, look, I consider myself a minority, you know, in the United States of America. And, like, I like to see more of me represented on screen, but I don't want it just for the sake of doing it. Like, hey, let's put some black people on here. Let's put some Asian people on. Let's put some gay people on here. Like, if it's a good story, they have a story to tell, which this could be. I hope that's the case. Then I want to see it. But just to throw it out there for diversity's sake isn't always a good thing. That's why I always have caution with this. But I trust these guys. I love Mark Guggenheim. I saw him twice at Comic-Con. Mm. One at a Marvel panel. He's doing a comic book for Marvel. And then for the DC Warner Brothers panel, of course, for The Flash. And Legends of Tomorrow. He's a great creator, great writer. He used to be a lawyer, by the way. So I'm excited to see what he's going to do. And I trust this creative team, especially with Greg Berlanti. I mean, he's the man.
I think the one thing I get out of this is that they introduced the gay character in 1973. Risky move by DC. I mean,
one of my favorite gay characters is Batwoman. She's a lesbian. And I mean, I've seen her, you know, of course, more in the comic books. But I mean, she's a fantastic character. She's done well. And it's not because she's gay. It's because she's a great character that happens to be gay. It's all about character first, you know, whether it's the show Transparent, where they're doing somebody who's, it's like, that's fine, but the characters are interesting. That's why I like the show. It's not because they're trans or they're gay or they're black or they're white. Give me a good character and I'm going to watch it no matter what.
I agree.
And the other thing is nobody, like, we've never sat on the show and I've never had to be like, so you guys, I'm straight. Yeah. And because it's just not even a thing. And I look forward to the time where we don't have to even discuss it because it's just... part
Same
of the thing.
Same thing as the John Cho in Star Trek. Like, who cares if he's gay? If he can run the Enterprise, who give a crap?
Yeah, if he knows how to go into Warp 7, that's all that matters.
Get it. You've got the con.
Warp 7. On Earth 4, where everybody's singing.
Everybody's singing.
There you go. All right, guys, that was Superhero Rundown. We are going to go into, spoiler alert, throw it up there, Cody. There we go. For the next, I want to say about 8 to 10 minutes, we are going to talk about Mr. Robot, and then we're going to talk about the Night of. Full spoiler reviews of the most recent episodes. So we will start this week with Mr. Robot. This may be, and I said I watched this episode twice, this may be top 10 episodes of television I've ever watched in my life.
Wow.
I thought it was unbelievable. The whole like Full House sitcom thing
loved
was, if we were talking about like genre outside of a genre episode, like musical inside a superhero, this was so well done. The jokes were so dark, but so well timed, the laugh track, that whole thing. And you could have, you know, the genius behind Sam Esmail and the whole production crew and the writing staff and whatever, they could have gone in a weird direction where that, where it really didn't make sense. It was almost like an extension, but they brought everything. It almost felt a full circle show within a show, and it didn't take me out of Mr. Robot. It brought me more into it.
Totally. I loved it. I thought visually it was so fantastic. I thought that it was also really interesting because this, like Mr. Robot slash Edward, this episode was the most interesting the character's been, because between the first scene and the last scene, we saw this really soft, wonderful version of a father.
Yeah.
Oh my God. And the last moment, I literally was like, but I loved that version of Christian Slater's character because we never know what's really going on. We never are really sure what's the truth. But that version of the dad is the version that I would like to believe is actually the closest to who he really is.
Mm-hmm.
But I loved visually what it happened. I continue to have one huge sticking point with the show. If stupid Dom is the one who takes this whole thing down, F Society, I'm gonna be pissed, because I don't think she as a character has earned that moment on the show.
Agreed.
And I want Portia Doubleday to have a little more chill. Like Angela with like her hard stares. Yeah. Like
she's intense.
Well, but she
sometimes
did it.
She does get a little much, Portia Doubleday, I think.
I love her, but when she did it with Cisco, I was like, oh, just talk. And then when she did it with the guy who was trying to pick up on her, I'm like, ah, just talk.
Yeah.
And then when she did it at the end with Dom, I'm like, dude, just talk. Come on. Is that,
I think it's a sign of her becoming robotic.
You know? Mrs. Robot?
Oh, yeah. I never thought about that. It's not what I was going, but yeah. Mrs. Robot.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because she's just saying those things like, I am special, I am important, like over and over again. Hurts her mantra. I mean, she's robotic now.
She is, 100%.
She's more machine now than man. Twisted and evil.
He's not a man, he's a machine.
It's getting so good, though. I was really frustrated. So, not this episode, but the one before. I was really frustrated because I felt like the only great scenes we got were the ones in China.
Mm-hmm.
This episode, from start to finish, I thought was so brilliantly paced. I loved the opening section. And I am more and more really starting to think that everything we're seeing with Rami Malek is, he's in a mental institution, and this is like his crazy inside the mental institution.
I don't think so.
What do you think? Where do you think he is?
It was until Craig Robinson's character took him to that other dark place. Like, he was in the hospital, literal hospital.
Right.
And then they took him away to kind of lock him away. It's like, look, you're working for me. We're not going to let you out because you know too much now.
I don't know. I still feel like,
you think he's still
I feel like it's like the movie Sucker Punch.
Okay.
I feel like we're at different levels in the mental institution, and he's the doctor, and like these are the different things.
Sorry, your phone's about to fall off your chair.
Oh, thanks, Boo. Yeah. I don't even care. Throw it! Throw it all to the wind! We're talking about Mr. Robot!
It's like a dream within a dream within a dream.
Yeah, but see, I love it.
I sometimes hate that kind of, like, the dream within a dream. Like, at the end, it's like Dallas when they, who shot JR?
Or
Bobby died or came out of the shower. And it's like, it's all been a dream. I don't think that Mr. Robot would do that to us, necessarily. However, I think that the one beautiful thing that happened in this episode, the sitcom part for me was just so well done. But when Craig Robinson tells him, like, the moment he looked at me and realized I was the only reason he was alive is one of the great, and you see it.
That's a villain. That's a great villain that moment. That's a great villain moment.
Unbelievably good villain moment.
Yeah.
And I just, this was the episode where I fell back in love with the sister. She's that actress who hasn't been in a ton of stuff is absolutely fantastic.
I love
her. And she's beautiful. And, I wish she'd, I know her character's not supposed to smile, but when you look at pictures of her away from the show, she's always smiling. Yeah. She's a very pretty girl. She's always has that like sad her look on her face.
Talk about casting. If they're going to cast Rami Malek, they got to find a girl that matches his eye size. And they both have beautifully large eyes.
Yeah. No, she's awesome.
There was something about the show. The first few episodes of this season of Mr. Robot, I had to be in the right place to watch it because I had to pay attention. This one, I was engulfed by the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I rewatched it immediately after to catch things. Again, like I said, this is top 10 episodes of TV I've watched in my life. Just so well done. I'm giving this one a solid 5 out of 5 nays.
Dude, I'm with you. I thought it was awesome. I'll give it a 5 out of 5.
Yeah.
5 out of 5 for me. As well. Yeah. So I'm not good at doing that motion because it's hard for me to like silence it. I'm afraid I'm actually going to say it.
Yeah.
So.
Well, don't say it, David. Yeah. All right.
Nice.
Let's go into the night of. Talk about it. This show on HBO, guys. We're still staying with the spoiler alerts. We're going to transition to the night of here on HBO. This show, we've said it all along, this has become a real obsession with a lot of people. There's been. Just a whole cult following of the show. This is that new show where people come up to me because they know, you know, that we're on this show and they say, what show? I'm finished this. What should I watch? And I've just been saying Mr. Robot or Night Of right now. If you're not watching those shows that are on television right now, you're really missing out on something super, super special. This episode just solidified the fact that what we were talking about last week is that it having never been the cool kid in school and you finally are, you'll do anything to fit in.
I like your tweet that I'm sure you're going to talk about that.
I have new theories, you guys. Yeah, okay, so last episode we began and we ended with the UV light. And we know the cat is back, and I've said all along, the cat is the key to this whole damn thing. So I still believe that the cat's going to play a big part. But after watching this last episode, so we didn't pick up with the Dwayne Reed storyline, I'm starting to think, because Freddie has that line, family is everything, that Freddie and Dwayne Reed are related. And the reason Freddie is sucking Nas in the way he is because he's covering up the hit. And he was involved in it. Oh. And I think that the dad probably hired them, the stepdad. I think the dude at the like corner is just a red herring.
I think the financial guy might have slept with a girl.
That makes sense.
He's not that much older than her. Yeah, I feel it. Yeah.
Like, they keep showing us the deer, and I'm like, is there something the deer is going to show us also?
Is there a camera in that deer?
Well, I wonder that. I wonder if there's, but I know for sure, I think the cat and the UV light will reveal something. But the thing with Nas this episode was when he was getting the tattoo on his knuckles, I'm like, you dumb.
Sinbad.
But even worse, I'm like, you can't cover that up and then the lone wolf tattoo on his arm. I get that that's the name of the production company, but come on, man. He's starting to go down this rabbit hole where I'm wondering, like we said last week, when you never belong and suddenly you belong, and and Freddie is like sucking him in and making him feel like you would prefer to stay here than be out in the world.
There's something to be said about a sociopathic man that is that charming.
Oh, yeah.
Because, you know, there was a line in an episode of Sopranos when Adriana is talking to the FBI agent, and Adriana starts talking about Tony, and it's later on in the series, and she sort of has a little crush on Tony. Mm-hmm. And the FBI agent says, I could see that. He's real alpha male, right? Same thing in prison is, yes, he's the alpha male, he's the king of the castle, whatever the case may be, but there's something just so very charming about him that I'd be like, well, I mean, I'll smoke crack with him again.
Oh, worse, it's heroin. Yeah. He's smoking heroin. I was like, oh, come on, man, don't do that. Please don't do that.
You're sure? He got 4 8-balls. Wasn't that 8-balls that they were smoking?
I assumed that it was.
Nah. Your guys' drug knowledge is just insane.
Wait,
it's
what was
coke.
It?
They're smoking crack.
Then why isn't it a rock?
No, because he got the 8-balls of coke out of his butt the last episode, and he puts it in there. They're basically freebasing coke.
Oh, they're freebasing. Yeah. Oh, I feel better. I thought it was heroin, and I was very upset. But then why?
You know what's a shame, though? It's a shame because.
You know, how is this freebase? Is it realistic?
Is it real? Unlike on vinyl, he could have just.
Yeah. Well, but that was the thing, was it felt like he went into a heroin nod, which was why I thought it was heroin.
If you go back to the show, the movie Traffic, when the daughter, Michael Douglas's daughter, freebases coke, she goes in that thing because it's a weird thing. I did a drug research paper on it in college. I took one of those classes.
It was a research paper.
Guys, I'm not a drug expert. You guys, you can't be saying that about me.
We're not saying that. We're just saying you are knowledgeable. Yeah. Wait, but can we stop and talk about the best moment on the show? He put on shoes, you guys.
Yes.
He put on shoes. And I was so excited. I was watching with like 6 people and everyone was like, ah, shoes!
Well, we were watching it and I looked and I go, look at his feet. Look at his feet. And it was a long shot. It was a long shot. You didn't see his feet right away. And I was like, no, there's nothing new with his feet. And then it cuts off and he's putting shoes and socks.
Oh, yeah.
And she's like, how did you catch that? I said, because they've done it for the first 5-6 episodes. They have put the emphasis on that man's feet. So as soon as you see him, you go right to his feet and look at it.
So here's what I think.
It's going to come back.
I think, right? It's coming back.
Yeah, it's coming back.
The UV light is coming back. Yep. The cat's going to get out because somebody tweeted out a picture. And I'm like, that picture is new. Yep. That picture is not a still we've seen where he's walking past in the gross outdoor-y shoes. And the cat is laying at his feet. The UV light's gonna come on, and we're gonna see something on the cat that will finally give us the answers. But this is what's so fascinating. I really don't know if Nos did it or not.
Well, see, that's the thing, Sasha. I want to go even deeper because this is one of your tweets last night.
Yeah.
Is it about the results, or is it about what you were talking about in your tweet about a man going into prison, a regular guy? Yeah, he pushed a guy down the stairs. That's because they were picking on him. They pushed him to the edge and he shoved a kid down the stairs.
That doesn't
mean some like evil person, but is it about a good person going bad? Remember what John Turturro's character was talking about? He said, okay, you go down to 10 or 12 years, 10 years max maybe, but you go away for more than 12, like you're going to go in a regular guy, you're going to come out a criminal.
Yeah.
He's kind of already becoming a criminal.
Yeah, totally.
And it's only been a month or two.
Yeah. Right.
So, I mean, is this about a good man going bad in the prison system while our justice system is, you know, turning its wheels? Or is it about the case? Maybe it doesn't matter who did. I mean, of course, we want to know.
Yeah.
But maybe it's about him just coming out different.
I mean, we're going to talk about...
His mom said, did I raise a monster?
Yeah. We're going to talk about something later on in the show. But the criminal justice system has been the subject of some really great television recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think it has shot... We now have this light being shined on the fact that it is so corrupt and it is so coverted.
Yeah.
And they're really... is no true sense of justice. And I was thinking, I don't know if that's ultimately what the show's going to be about, but the fact that that is such a major undertone of it now, I find really fascinating.
Remember Detective Box, like, he's aware of this. He's like, we can't exist without each other.
Right. Yeah.
And one of the first couple episodes, he's like, look, he's a lawyer, but I can't exist without him. We all exist in this machine.
But hold on.
It's
Detective Box now is becoming so conflicted because as soon as he pulled out that map and saw all the places that they went where he could have killed her, but didn't kill her, and it would have been so much easier to do it at the beach. I'm waiting for him to step up.
And he's
to the
hearing,
plate.
And he's remembering the story told. Was like, you know, he's everywhere he said he was. He still hasn't explained one knife wound. It's like,
When he's up on the stand next week, I wonder if he's going to have a crisis of conscience and he's going to be like, wait a second, this isn't how these things go. I've been a cop for so long. I know how the behavior works.
Yeah,
this episode, I think the one thing it did give me was this blind sense of hope. Like hope with John Turturro, hope that he wasn't guilty. And then it crushed me with the parents delivering groceries and
then being
a janitor. And this show, I'll tell you what, since this show started airing, I did not sleep well on Sunday nights. It just like affects me in a really deep, deep way. Mm. And this episode, especially the tattoos, the smoking, the crack, I was like, God, they're turning this really nice young kid who was going places into a drug addict maniac.
Also, too, the sense, and we're going on about the show, but like the sense of detail. I remember when he was in prison and the first time when he got the shoes as a gift, it's for traction. Remember, I loved how the opening shot, they focus on his feet.
Yeah.
He doesn't have the shoes on. He doesn't need the traction anymore. He's so protected, but he's not.
Yeah.
Guy had a knife to his throat. He could have killed him.
Yeah.
He's protected, but he's not really protected. How safe are you in prison? Yeah. Any moment could be your last. So.
Absolutely.
So much drama. It's
okay,
good.
So Sasha, out of five.
Five kitty cats.
Yeah. Oh, is that where we're going?
It's just what I'm doing.
Okay.
I love it. I give it a 5 out of 5.
5 out of 5.
Yeah, out of 5.
Yeah.
This show so far is a 5 out of 5.
God, man. This has been the one thing, you know, like HBO, like almost like summer movies has been kind of a little bit of a letdown thus
far.
But TV
has been a step up.
But this, this night of, I'll tell you what, man. All right. Let's go to the pilot review, guys. The new Netflix show, The Get Down. Get Down. Kind of a letdown to me, I'll be honest with you. A little pun there. Wasn't my favorite. Like, you know, we've been talking about this since, I think we first mentioned this on week 2 of TV Talk, like our second episode. And I'm not really a big fan of the production value. I'm not a great fan of the acting. I think that I wanted a lot more out of this show. The only thing that I caught that I recognized was that they said their name Nikki Barnes. And Nikki Barnes was the Cuba Gooding Jr. character in American Gangster with Denzel Washington and Russell Crowe. Anyway, cut that, and he was the gangster in the thing. The shootout scene at the end I thought was absolutely great, and that's what made me go and start watching episode 2. Like every other show, I'm going to give it 3 episodes and see if it really hooks me in. But I got to tell you, the whole thing of the show, there is not one part of me that is totally in love with it or wanting to keep watching more. I thought it would suck me in right away, and it definitely did not.
I felt like every minute of this 90-minute premiere was an exercise in patience and torture. I was so frustrated, and I was so excited for it because I love the Red Curtain trilogy of Baz Luhrmann's. Mm-hmm. And this, I was like, okay, so we're gonna get like Strictly Ballroom, but we're also gonna get some Moulin Rouge, but it's gonna be like New York in the 70s, and like I was there in the 80s. It's so profoundly whack. It's so bad. It reminds me of, you know, when you're watching like a CGI movie and suddenly you have that moment where you like really see the outline of the green screen and your brain shifts and goes, oh, this is totally fake. That's how I felt the whole time. There is some good acting. There is not a single character I care about. None of them. The like Bruce Leroy ripoff. I don't give a crap about that dude.
That's the dude from Dope. And I Dope was him. My favorite movie of 2015.
Yeah, Dope was one of my top five last year. Yeah.
It's Shameik Moore is a great actor. Yeah. A great actor. Mm. This part is worthless. Jaden Smith, get off of camera. You are an abomination.
The only reason why he's acting is because of his dad.
Yeah.
He's
and not his mom. Good. Let's give it up for his mom,
I love
Jada. Too.
I love Will. But he does not have the charisma of his mom and dad at all. Not
and
a shred of it.
The girl who's supposed to be like the discovery, she is like,
I can't tell if it's the writing or the show. The kids are the weak point. I mean, I don't think the kids are very
Jimmy
good.
Jimmy Smits was good?
And I'm comparing.
In Smits we trust, man.
But see, Jimmy Smits is a high enough caliber that even when he's hammy, even though it's not good, because he's a good actor, he can pull it off. These kids, I don't feel like they have it that level
Sinéad
yet.
And I had a really good conversation about it. Sinéad.
I mean, he's doing the whole, like, you know, he's doing the accent kind of thick. And Giancarlo Esposito, who's in a fantastic, one of my favorite characters on Breaking Bad.
He's terrible in this.
It's the writing's not good.
But it's not just the writing. It's the writing, it's the direction, and it's
I don't mind the visuals. I like the look of it. I'll admit. I like the look of it.
I feel
visuals.
Like it looks so
But I like
fake.
The music. Like that opening song with Nas singing. I know that wasn't Nas on stage.
I love the Nas music.
Well, it's interesting because I think it's actually, I don't know, I did not look online, but I think it's actually David Diggs, who was in Hamilton, who just won the Tony and is now leaving. I think that's who physically is.
Right, but that's Nas's voice, right?
But it's Nas's voice, Nas. And I'm like, why wouldn't you just use the dude who's like a great rapper? Yeah. It just feels like bad choice after bad choice. And everything I hated about The Great Gatsby is on screen in this.
That's what we were saying. Sinéad, what do you think?
I mean, It's such a bummer because, like you said, we've been talking about this since forever ago. This did not capture anything that I thought it would. Mm-hmm. It is so boring. Mm-hmm. And, like, even if you don't get technical about it, even if you don't get critical about it, like, the green screen sucks, and you're right. Mm-hmm. It does look really fake. All of that stuff aside, I am so not interested just in what they have given us.
Totally.
Like, the story. The acting is awful. I think it's literally the worst thing ever that Netflix has put out in a long time. Of something that had so much expectation, I guess, is what I mean. Because obviously there's bad TV. But for some reason, this one seemed like it was going to stick. Like, I really thought this was
I was so excited when I saw it. I was like, oh, it's coming out. I totally forgot that it was coming out August 12th. Yeah. And I wrapped Film HQ on Friday morning. I came straight here, and I started it. And 30 minutes in, I was like...
That's because the potential of what is so exciting. Like, rarely ever do you get a story that you just hear the synopsis and you're like, damn, this is going to be awesome. Like, it's going to be, like, real. And they're
introducing real people, like Grandmaster Flash.
And the cuts to those, like, news segments and all that stuff throughout seems
jarring.
So weird in this show. Like, they'll cut to, like, real footage of old news. And that was, to me, was the most interesting thing.
Yeah.
But then it would go back to the show, and I'd be like, this doesn't even seem like
it's the same
thing. Do you know
what, too, is, like, when they were going to the real footage and then cutting back to real life, the quality of film is so jarring. That
so
you're like,
jarring.
Oh. And also, too, I think it's a lot of style over substance. I can't get on these kids too much because I need to see them, except for, you know, the guy from Dope, in more things because, like, the kids in Stranger Things were so good together.
Yeah,
the chemistry was perfect.
Good.
And they don't have chemistry, and I don't think it's their fault, but there's so much style instead of the substance. Like, I don't think they can connect because there's no connection in the story.
But it just doesn't seem like they get it.
Yeah,
like, they
I don't know if it's their fault.
But it also seems like bad casting because there's that moment in the disco where the girl's dancing and then the main kid shows up, but they can't dance and they look super awkward and staged and like everything about it is just uncomfortable
it's
and weird.
Unfortunate.
And there's that moment where he's like standing up and doing his poem. He's reciting his poem. And for a second, I was like, oh, I have the chills. Oh, this might turn a corner.
Yeah, about his mom,
And then it just kept going and going and going, and I felt no emotional connection to it. Yeah. And the way it was shot was weird. And
it would be way better if the girl was in love with him and they were like together, and like they looked at it like, we're gonna spend the rest of our life together. Let's focus and let's go and do
right.
this. Then,
yeah.
then
kind of like a West Side Story.
Yeah, yeah, and plus that would also like open the door for something like real and realistic too. And the fact that she's like Puerto Rican, he's Black, like that's a storyline that's great to explore during the 70s where like race was a thing. Like there's so many things they could do with the story to make it interesting and make it more realistic, because I'm sure that is really what it was like in the 70s. And they're not doing any of
that. And it's good to, and I hate to bring this up, but we have to because it's going to be brought up in the comments. It's great to see all these faces on screen.
Yes. Absolutely.
I'm happy for these kids getting work. It's great, but it's just, it's not, this isn't the right project. I want to do something else.
The show is bad.
It's a mess.
I got attacked on Twitter, and then it turned out somebody was like, I'm just ripping your chain, because they said that I didn't like it because it was about African-Americans, like
that
actually,
were racist.
Like, creating their own culture. And I was like, dude, are you have me so wrong. Right. So wrong, it's not even funny. Because this show was the show I was most excited for. Like, this is my Star Trek. This is my Star Trek if I'm David. Like, I love musicals. I love Baz Luhrmann, although not Australia or The Great Gatsby or this. I think that a lot of these kids could be incredible. Mm-hmm. Not Jaden Smith, but it's just so mishandled.
Well, if it's like, if someone was like, Sinead, you're gonna star in this show and it's set in the 70s, I'd be like, all right, well, I don't know anything about the 70s, so like, help me understand the ins and outs of the way people talk. That, like, I'm not from the 70s, and I know that this has no 70s written all over it.
Apparently.
Well,
not at all.
We think that there can be a show that is A, period, or B, a show about music that works.
We've yet to see it, that's for sure. And some of the greatest minds in TV have tried and have failed, so maybe it's way harder than
it was. But it's not TV, they're the greatest minds of film.
It's true.
It's Cameron Crowe, it's Martin Scorsese, it's Baz Luhrmann. Maybe they don't understand how to do the transition. Maybe we need somebody like Joss Whedon to show up and show us how to do a musical show. Maybe we need somebody like, I mean, maybe David O. Russell could do it. He's gonna do something, period. But
Like
when I look at, you know, the People versus O.J. Simpson, they captured the 90s and never made it feel like weird and hokey.
And like, oh, my new favorite Nirvana song just came out because it's 96.
Yeah. They put a perm in and it actually was a plot point, and it wasn't stupid or hokey. The word that kept coming into my head when I was watching this was corny. This show is corny. The Get
and
Down.
We were reading
People
before
OJ.
This is that the production went way, way over budget. They were calling, the people that were working on it was calling it the shutdown because it just went through so many growing pains and whatever the case may be in the production, and it shows. It really does. All right, we have to move on. Guys, we're going to really do rapid fire, quick high and lows this week. Sinead, let's get this going. What's first?
All right, Thomas Gibson has been fired from Criminal Minds.
This is a high. This is hysterical.
Because he's not going to solve it, you guys.
He's not going to solve it.
He got fired.
Give Macuga credit. We're talking about procedural television, talking about network TV.
Yeah!
Criminal Minds is the number one on the roundup.
Number one, Criminal Minds. Kick some more people. Get fired. They're going to do a lawsuit now, too.
That was
Sinead,
hilarious.
What's next?
Making a Murderer is Brendan Dassey. His conviction has been overturned.
Hi. Look at what happens.
I'm afraid of this. See, I'm if he's innocent, then I'm so happy. But I
didn't you watch the show?
I did.
He's innocent.
Yeah, I hope so.
He was super innocent.
I hope so.
Hi.
Okay.
I'm happy if he
what's
is.
What's next,
though.
Sinead?
Ray Donovan renewed for season 5.
Listen, I think this season of Ray Donovan, the second half has really redeemed itself. I'm going high.
I only watched the first episode. I was that's
enough. I fell off, but I'll come back.
Okay, high for me. Yeah. Sinead, what's next?
The Olympics.
Yay!
America!
Total high.
The hungry butts on the water polo team.
Yeah,
that was a good clip.
The coverage has been outstanding.
It's been good.
Oh,
yeah,
it
has
they're
not
so great.
Suffered.
You and Michael Phelps just making me cry.
You have the older document in there. You had one more before the Olympics there, Sinead.
Number D.
Just we want to throw in there for Sasha. Containment.
I finished watching it, you guys. I got all the way through. And let me tell you, it sucked right up until the end. That show gets a big fat you from me.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Rocco's Modern Life TV movie.
Oh, I'm going high. I'm psyched to see it.
I didn't watch it. I didn't. I was more of a
Cody's
Rugrats
giving us a
kid.
Super high in the background.
Cody's
See, I was more of a Rugrats and Doug, so I don't. Sorry.
I love Rocco's Modern Life. I'm going high. Sinead, what's next?
Last Chance U gets a second season.
Yay! Listen,
now is this going to be Last Chance U? Is this going to be the same school? They're going to do another junior college.
No, it's
somewhere.
It's, no,
I hope
it's
the same school.
Same school. Oh,
so we're going to get more Miss Wagner.
See, I'm a little right here on it because I don't want this to go, I don't want this to go like 2-a-days on MTV. Though I don't think
I
it will.
I love 2-a-days.
Hoover, high. But I am going to go high because we all love it so much.
Yeah, I love that. All right. The nightly show with Larry Wilmore canceled at Comedy Central.
It's a shame that this show was kind of swept under the rug because I think it had some potential if it had the right showrunners. I don't think Comedy Central gave it the right attention it could have because Larry Wilmore is very funny.
I'm the reason that show got canceled. I literally never watched one episode.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. It's my fault too.
Yeah, I blame myself.
Help
out.
Sorry.
Sorry, Larry.
I never heard of it, so I'll take also the blame partly for that.
Definitely, really so your fault, Sinéad. All right, Sinead's fault. All right, what's next, Sinead?
Drop the mic. Picked up for series from James Corden's show.
It's a rap battle.
This is like
if anything, they should have greenlit
James
Carpool
Corden's
karaoke.
Blowing up.
Yeah,
like
I
with
thought
his karaoke
is
and everything.
Greenlit for Apple TV.
Wow,
this is the second show that he sold off of one of his bits in the last like 2 or 3 weeks.
Yeah. Crazy,
but this seems like a very bad idea because Drop the Mic is so obviously scripted, and certain people are not good on it.
And it's a really good bit, but I also thought lip sync battle was a good bit, and it's become a popular show. Who knows?
But
I'm going to go low. I'm going to go low.
I'm going low too.
Low.
No,
I like the Carpool Karaoke.
I do.
She
asked me what's next?
PLL in 30 seconds.
Go.
Get it, girl.
Fire. Okay, so Jason is back from Ethiopia. It's the first time
seen.
So
what was he doing in Ethiopia?
He was doing charity work. He's a really great
guy. Nice
guy. He's back. It's the first time we've seen him in the past 5 years. And basically, I don't think he's gotten a haircut in the past 5 years because he's rocking like hair that's long as mine. He looks like Jesus, Jason, but I'm kind of into it, not going to lie. Toby tells Spencer that the house that he was building for Yvonne, his fiance, was actually intended for her. And then she breaks out and cries, but that leads to nothing because Toby is engaged. Hannah also tells Caleb that her and Jordan broke up, so that's kind of hinting at their future. And then the last thing is that the girls discover that Mary Drake had a second child and they don't know who it is. And they get a message from this person who we think is the second child saying that if they find out who that person is before he finds or she finds out that who killed Charlotte, then they're basically all gonna die.
Man, 30 seconds with Sinead on Pillow Liars. Love it. All right, let's go next.
Internet
high maintenance trailer.
I thought I wasn't gonna like this, but I'm like sort of like right here, so like mid high.
I thought it looked exactly like the shorts that I've watched, and I don't understand how they're gonna make a 30-minute show out of it. They better make him real interesting and likable. So I'm like right here.
Yeah, I'm
here
with Sasha.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, last one, Shasty.
Rogan and Goldberg jump on to produce Singularity at FX.
These guys are everywhere.
They are everywhere. You know, they're producing decent stuff. Sasha's Party was okay. I thought Preacher had its highs.
I thought you were saying Sasha's
lows.
Party. I was like, my parties are the bomb.
The bomb.
had a party with Rogan and
Goldberg. I would always invite you. But
Singularity
you
is like an artificial intelligence show and like a comedy based around like artificial intelligence, which I think is a really cool idea. So let's hope they bring it to Tuesday.
High.
I'm gonna go high.
That's a high on that one.
I'm gonna go high.
High for potential, Sasha. Come on now, turn
I'm putting it right here because Preacher.
She's going Joaquin.
See, you're Joaquin Phoenix on Gladiator. Like.
All right. That was our highs and lows, guys, here on TV Talk. All right, we're going to go into some Twitter questions, guys. I sent a tweet out yesterday, and you guys sent in some amazing questions. We only have a couple today, but I saved all of them. I can't wait for us to all answer them. So thank you guys, first, for being amazing fans, second of all, for using the hashtag CollatorTVTalk, and third, for sending us in some really, really good questions. So, Sinead, what's first?
Shane Clifford says, in honor of the Collider video rap, which TV show, past or present, would have benefited with a rap battle episode?
Are you kidding me? Slater and Zach versus the whole Valley team in the Nidic wrestling match. Instead of wrestling, they have a rap battle.
That would have been rad.
Boom, Saved by the Bell.
That's I would really good. Love to see in The Walking Dead
I
next
gonna,
season.
Yeah.
I want to see Rick and Negan do a rap battle. Like let's see.
Lucille.
So yeah, he's got
and
the bat.
And Tommy's the back like, what?
Yeah, right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We could do that. Like he's got the bat and Rick just stands up and just starts just rapping. And they start freestyling back
you
and forth.
You know what?
I
That'd be dope,
that.
Right?
Yeah. I would love that. Yeah. So as I've been called a Seinfeld hater, if Seinfeld had a rap battle episode, I would have liked that.
What about Seinfeld versus Friends in a rap battle?
Oh, Friends wins.
You guys, I'm
going to
cry.
That's too much. That's too much for
Sinead. All right, Sinead, what's
next? All
right, next?
Josh Huggins says, love the show. I recently binged all of The Wire. Best show ever. What new shows have that kind of potential?
Oof. God, I mean, The Wire.
If The Night Of like wasn't an anthology series, then maybe. Yeah. But it's going to, if we get another season, it's going to be a whole different story.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, what Game of Thrones is for me.
Yeah.
But and
we're
I just saw that.
HBO.
I mean, now Oz is available on HBO Go. So go back and watch Oz.
Oh yeah, go back and watch Oz. That's the best recommendation.
Chris
we
Maloney,
can,
man.
There's as far as new shows go. Oh man, this
that's
is really tough.
The Wire-ish. I don't know that we've seen it yet.
Ray Donovan is Showtime's. They're trying pretty hard to do it. Yeah. There aren't a lot out there, man. You really started high. To compare anything to The Wire is really, really difficult.
Because The Wire, like, when you're watching it, like, you're like, what am I watching? When I see Ray Donovan, I'm like, this is a scripted television show.
You know what else you could binge?
You know?
It's not like The Wire, but HBO show is 6 Feet Under. One of the greatest series finales in the history of television.
That's what all my friends say.
Didn't Arrow say that they were taking some inspiration?
From The Wire?
Yep. No, from 6 Feet Under and The Wire.
And they also just cast Dolph Lundgren, so...
That is, I'm happy about that. That makes me happy. And no more flashbacks after the season.
It does. All right, Sinead, last question.
All right, Ryan Unicomb says, name your absolute top realistic pick for TV Batman in the Supergirl Flash Arrow universe.
This casting?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Like if they're, okay. Like who would bring Batman
who
to
could
TV?
Be, also, yeah, I think not just Batman, who can be Bruce Wayne?
I think the person who fits the CW model, who could also be Batman and Bruce Wayne.
I'm waiting.
Is Matt Bomer.
We bring him up every time.
All the time. He just looks like a superhero. Yeah. Yeah.
He looks like a CW superhero. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's got the pretty. Mm-hmm. He's interesting.
He is.
I think he'd be really good.
So I was like looking at what everyone else was saying just because I was curious. And there are numerous sites that have actually put together a list. And the number one pick across the board was Jensen Ackles.
Oh. What?
There's been rumors of him leaving Supernatural to join the WB superhero universe for a few years now.
And I think because I've heard that before. I don't know if I really see it, but then I could also maybe see somebody like Ian Somerhalder too.
Yeah. Oh yeah, same kind of thing. Pretty,
I know.
Pretty. Good jawline. Always looks angry. Good piercing eyes from behind the cape.
Those guys
the
are
cowl.
So small. I've been next to Ian Somerhalder. Those guys are both males from Vampire Diaries. They're so petite.
Yeah,
like,
they're tiny.
They're
little
so
little
like just like break. They're so tiny. Yeah.
I know. I bring him up a lot because he's my buddy. But he's more of a, I guess he's a movie guy. But I think Scott Eastwood would be a great Batman
I'm
on
in.
TV.
You're friends
I'm
with Clint Eastwood's son?
Yeah. Hold on. I'll tell you. Wait. How do you? Hold on.
I'm about to interview him. So you need okay.
But I was gonna go, and as soon as I said it, I would love to see a black Batman, Damon Wayans Jr. I think that dude is awesome. He's funny. He's a playboy kind of a dude. He's very like multi-versed, and I think he's a very talented actor. I would love to see him as a TV
Batman.
That's
cool. I could maybe see that.
Black Bruce Wayne. All right.
I don't know if I could see it as like the Batman, but I could see him as a Bruce Wayne for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Why are you looking at me like that? What are you giving me that stank face for?
Damn all right,
stank face.
All right, there we go, guys.
I do enjoy Wayne's brother, though.
Twitter questions. Thank you guys for sending them in. We have so many more to get to in the weeks to come, so stay tuned. If you sent one in and we haven't asked it yet, we have some good ones up there. All right, time for everybody's favorite part of the show.
What time is it, Josh?
It's the pick of the week. I really tried hard on that one. Guys, I'm going to pick this week. I'm going to pick HBO's Tremé. It is... a very, very low-rated show. Not that many people watched it. It was the follow-up project after The Wire for David Simon, and it takes place in New Orleans post-Hurricane Katrina and the cleanup. I have a personal tie to New Orleans, a lot of family down there, so there's a personal place in my heart for New Orleans, and this show really captured the vibe of New Orleans. A lot of my buddies were like, why do you watch this show? Just the commercials look just like they're playing horns and then there's a show. It really is a lot about the music. It's a lot about the cover-ups. It's a lot about the housing. It's a lot about the culture of New Orleans. It goes from food to music to locals to non-locals to the rebuild of the city, everything that's going on around it. It's a show that encapsulates everything and nothing at the same time, and it's totally classic David Simon. Obviously, The Wire is a much different and better show because it's more culturally relevant.
You know? Even Anthony Bourdain wrote an episode on Tremé.
But Tremé, absolutely fantastic. If you get a chance to check out Tremé, it'll give you a whole new respect for the people and the culture of New Orleans, Louisiana.
I love Tremé. And when you watch it, all you want to do, it's kind of like when I watch Y5O. It's just like, I got to book a trip. Yeah. I got to book a trip.
I know. Mm-hmm. We're going back in October. Yeah. Anyway, that is my...
Yeah.
All right, guys, that'll do it for us here on Collider TV Talk. Special thanks to Cody Hall, who always runs our board, and Adam Smith. Special thanks to Ray Aura as well for always doing the amazing graphics here on the show. And a special thanks to you guys for always watching. Guys, if you don't watch Collider, if this is your first time watching a show on Collider because you saw the thumbnail, check out all the other shows. You got Movie Talk every day live. You have Nightmares. You have Heroes. You have Jedi Council. You have the Schmodown on Fridays. All kinds of amazing content. Top 10 shows. Sorry about that. With Collider News with Sinead, and they just did an amazing wrap. So if you guys aren't, if this is your first time on Collider, check out all the shows. Tell your friends. Do all the cool stuff here on Collider before we go. where can the good people find you, Sinéad DeVries?
I'm online at Sinéad DeVries and at thatsosinead.com. On Mondays, hanging out with my best friends in the entire world here on TV Talk. And then on Fridays, back for Movie Talk and hosting Mailbags over the weekend. If you guys like my PLL breakdowns every Monday, I do have an after show on the stream.tv with Ashley Mova, who's also here at Collider. And we do a full after show. So check it out.
And I left you a special little note.
We saw it. Oh, we loved it.
Oh, good. Yeah. Sasha Perl-Raver.
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Sasha Perl-Raver, on Mondays with my faves, on Thursdays with the Schmoes, and on Friday hosting FX Movie Download. And right now on the couch watching a lot of Olympics.
Absolutely. David.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at GriffinDE.
The man, the myth, the legend that is David Griffin.
I'm around. I'm here, people. You can find me.
Guys, I'm Josh Macuga at Josh Macuga on Twitter and Instagram. Here every Monday doing Collider TV Talk. My show, The Josh Macuga Show, on my YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. It's pretty easy. You can find me wherever. On Thursday with the Schmoes, Friday on the Schmodown, all kinds of places. And on Saturday on Comic-Con HQ doing a show called Film HQ. Guys, we love you guys here on Collider TV Talk. So tell your friends. And as always, thanks for watching. So put down the book. Pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.